as mentioned in our classes in Tanya, that you have to read Tanya differently to the way you read any other work. And that is that you have to read yourself into the Tanya. You have to find yourself in it. It's not a book about a topic. It's not a storybook or a history book or a philosophy or a theology book. It's a book about us. It's describing our inner world. And the only way to study Tanya meaningfully is to relate to it, to find yourself in it. In every line, every chapter, everywhere we go. Some parts of Tanya, it's readily easy to do that. And other parts, it takes more of a stretch of the mind. In the chapter that we saw last week, there was an in-depth description of the tzaddik, of somebody who is a righteous person. In fact, two levels of a tzaddik, a complete tzaddik and an incomplete tzaddik. Even the incomplete tzaddik is an extremely high level. It's somebody who never does anything immoral, never does the wrong thing, not only that, never is tempted to do the wrong thing, has no inner drive towards immorality whatsoever. It doesn't attract him at all. That is a tzaddik. Not only they don't do the wrong thing, they don't even want to do the wrong thing. But within that, there's two levels. There's a complete tzaddik and an incomplete tzaddik. An incomplete tzaddik doesn't do evil, doesn't want to do evil, but is not absolutely abhorred by evil. They're not totally disgusted by the existence of evil, and it's something that they could possibly have an attraction to. They don't, but they could, because they don't abhor it completely. Whereas a complete tzaddik is somebody who is so beyond it, so past it, that they do not do evil. They don't want or attempt to do evil. They don't even have the ability to tolerate evil. They're disgusted by it. It puts them off. They have nothing in them that relates to evil. That's the complete tzaddik. When we study those chapters that describe the tzaddik, it may be a little bit difficult to find ourselves in that directly, to find where we fit into that. Because they are extremely sublime and high levels, a level of existence that most of us have not reached, if we were to be honest. However, the next chapter we're going to study, chapter 11, may start to sound a bit more familiar. Because in chapter 11 we meet the Rasha, the wicked person. And the wicked person is someone who we can perhaps relate to a little bit more. For that reason, it's interesting, we've noted this before, that Rabbi Shneur Zalman, the author of the Tanya, the Alter Rebbe, spends much less time describing the Rasha. He doesn't go into it all that deeply. It's a short chapter, chapter 11, and we're only going to spend a short time on it, because this stuff we know. This is what we're more familiar with. We don't need deep explanations of this one. We just need to be told the facts, and it sounds right, rings a bell. And so it's not going to be too difficult to relate to chapter 11, the story of the Rasha. We're going to, in this chapter, we're going to look at those who have no regrets, the bad and the worse. That's chapter 11 of Tanya. In this chapter, we're going to answer also the following question. Is anyone so bad that they are beyond hope? When we're talking about wicked people, Rishoyim, those who are evil, is there an evil that's beyond the pale? Or is everybody redeemable? Is there always something that can turn around within every single person? Or are there some that are just beyond help, beyond hope, there's nothing we can do about them? Or putting it in different words, if a tzaddik can transform his animal soul to be holy, as we saw in the previous chapter, can a Rasha, a wicked person, corrupt his divine soul to be totally evil? In the previous chapters of Tanya, we learned that each one of us have two souls. We have a divine soul, which is holy, pure, beautiful, divine. And we have an animal soul, which is selfish, human at best, but animalistic and selfish and immoral at worst. These two sides of our personality, these two souls, are battling with each other. The tzaddik is somebody who has won the battle for the divine soul. His divine soul has totally taken control over every part of his personality, of his behavior. The tzaddik has transformed the animal soul. So what's a Rasha then? Is a Rasha somebody who has transformed their divine soul, that their divine energy is corrupted to the point where it serves the animal soul, and therefore, if you can have a tzaddik who's a complete tzaddik, what is a complete Rasha? Is a complete Rasha somebody who has taken their divine soul and completely turned it around, irredeemably, to the side of evil, selfishness, to the animalistic? Are there some people who they've finished the job, just like the tzaddik is past the battle, over it, beyond, no struggle anymore, on a totally higher plane. What about the other side of the spectrum? Is a complete rasha the same? We're going to look at that in detail in this chapter. Let's have a look at some text now from chapter 11 of Tanya. After discussing the various levels of a tzaddik, chapter 11 discusses the levels of a rasha and says that there is a person in whom the wickedness prevails more strongly, and all three garments of evil clothe themselves in him, causing him to commit more heinous and frequent sins. But intermittently he suffers remorse, and thoughts of repentance enter his mind from the quality of good that is in his soul, that gathers strength now and then. In other words, the nature of the rasha is, there are various levels of rasha. There's not just two levels, there's many levels. Just like with the tzaddik, there's many levels of tzaddik. Not just two. Two in general, but in more specific, there are many levels. With the rasha as well, there are many levels. Now, it could be that the rasha is somebody who is doing evil intermittently, every now and then. Not all the time. A wicked person does not necessarily mean somebody who is constantly and always involved in immorality. A rasha means somebody who does that which is forbidden, who performs immoral acts, who does things that they're not supposed to do, who transgresses the laws of God, who behaves immorally, even sometimes. Doesn't have to be all the time, doesn't have to be every day, but they do it. Because the tzaddik was somebody who never does any evil, that never does the wrong thing. The opposite is somebody who does the wrong thing, not necessarily all the time. And depending on how often and how deep the evil manifests itself in the rasha's life will depend on just how much of a rasha the person is. So if somebody who sins on a monthly basis, okay, that's not so bad. A weekly basis, a bit worse than that, daily, hourly, minute by minute, constantly, you're getting worse and worse. Depends on how much control, how much domination the animal soul has over this person's life. As we saw in the previous chapters about the wrestle, chapter 9 spoke about the battle between the two souls, that they both want total dominion. They're not going to settle with anything less. How far that battle has gone, how much territory has the animal soul conquered in your life, that will determine how far the person is a rasha. And so if somebody who is totally in the hands, in the clutches of the animal soul, is somebody who every move they make is selfish, and very often it will also be, if not evil, an accessory to evil. Meaning, when they sit and eat their dinner, the eating their dinner is to energize bad stuff. They're using that energy for no good. And so the eating the dinner, while itself is not an immoral act to do, but because of what they're going to do with that energy, because of what they want the strength from the food for, it is all a part of evil. They're involved deeply and entrenched in evil. That is a wicked person who is, their garments, their three garments of thought, speech, and action are deeply enclosed in evil. And so the sins that they commit will be more frequent, more often, and also worse sins. There's a hierarchy of sins. There are some sins that are considered worse than others. Even though the Talmud says we shouldn't measure sins, which is worse and which is not, the bottom line is when you do something against the divine will, it's bad. However, we do see the Torah itself does assign different punishments to different sins. There's a different level of blemish that different sins affect on our souls. There are some sins that cut our souls off from its source. There are other sins that cause a blemish that needs to be wiped off. There are different levels of sins. Depending on how deeply the animal soul has control of your life will determine how bad the type of sins that you'll do. Each one of us draws our line somewhere. Each one of us says that, oh, that I wouldn't do. You know, like even in jails, there are certain criminals that get beaten up because what they did is unacceptable. Meanwhile, who's beating them up? Somebody who also committed a crime, a violent crime, a horrible crime that everyone agrees. But there's a hierarchy even in jail of what's even worse. And so everybody has their line that I wouldn't go beyond that. This is too much for me. It's an ironic thing that most of us in our religious life, where we draw the line of this I wouldn't do, we see that as being balanced. That the place I'm at is balanced. that, you know, there are certain things I wouldn't do. Okay, I'm not so holy. I don't do everything. I'm not always doing the right thing. I'm not perfect. That I've accepted, I'm not a perfect person. But this I wouldn't do. That far I wouldn't go. This I wouldn't dream of. And we feel that the place we are in is the nice, balanced place right in the middle. There are certain people who do more than us. They're the holy people. They're the people who are extremely righteous. Some of them would even be extremists, going overboard, taking it a bit too seriously. They're the people that do more than us. They're the super ultra people. Then there are the people who do less than us, who do the things that we would never do, the line that we would never go across. Those people are really the wicked people. That's a Russia. That's a wicked person. I am nicely placed in the middle. Wherever I am, I'm nicely in the middle. This is somehow the way we justify in our mind. Tanya comes and adjusts that a little bit and says that no, there is a Russia, there is a Tzaddik, and there is a Benini, there's something in between, which we're going to meet soon. The Russia is somebody who sins. If you sin, you're a Russia. That's the category you're in. If it's more frequent, it's a bigger Russia. If it's less frequent, it's a lesser Russia, but it's in the category of a Russia. That there's no sin that is excusable, a sin that you know better, that you know you're not supposed to do it, and yet you do it, is a sin. There are lesser and bigger sins, but that doesn't justify it. There are different levels that a person might be on, but a sin is a sin. And anyone who sins is in the category of a Russia. Now, having said that, it's important to note, there are people who don't know any better, who don't know that you're not supposed to do these things, who were never taught it, who are not educated or don't realize the seriousness of doing certain things, and so therefore, such a person cannot be held accountable like a person who does know better. And that will be discussed in Tanya later on. Nevertheless, on a simple definition basis, a Russia is somebody who has committed an intentional sin. They know they're not supposed to do this, and yet they do it. Then you're in the category of a Russia.
Just to get some clarity, so when you mentioned the eating, I know you said it a few times in various lectures, but so when we eat, or whatever we do, and it's not directed towards a holy act, we are sinning. Is that what you're telling us? Just so I can get clear on
it. No. What Tanya said earlier, in the earlier chapters, is that when you do something such as eating, in a permissible fashion, there's nothing, no transgression, there's nothing evil about it. It is not a sin, and it can never be a sin if it's done right, if it's done in a moral way, it can never be a sin. However, the question is, where is that energy going? Is the eating, the food that you're taking in, is it going to goodness? Are you using that energy to do good, or are you using it to do further evil? That will then drag what would otherwise be neutral into evil or into good, depending on how you use it. It's never a sin to eat something that is permissible. It's not evil or sinful to sleep or to rest. These things are necessary things for our bodily health and to function. But depending on where you're going with that energy will depend on where you drag it. Do you drag it to this side or to that?
So are we supposed to, every time we eat, be using it for a holy cause? Is that what Tanya wants us to do?
What Tanya wants is that everything we do is for the sake of holiness. And so if you can do it on a conscious level, that's even better, meaning to consciously eat and saying, I'm eating for the sake of doing good. But even if you're not doing that, if you're eating and then doing good, doing something positive, furthering goodness in the world, so then the eating becomes a partner to that. Yes, that is what Tanya is asking of us. As we'll see when we go into what a Russia is anything less than that. If we're using our energy for negative, for bad, for evil, for immoral, then we're a Russia, that's where we're at. Which, like I said, is quite familiar to us. This is not too foreign.
Does that mean that, are you saying that if you eat and you don't binge after your meal, is the benching considered the holy act, that, or is it the thought of eating with the intention that I need to look after myself, I've got a family, a big family, and I need to eat this meal because I need to be able to be well enough to look after my children and energize myself and give myself strength.
Okay.
If I don't bench, does that mean it's not a holy act?
No. Benching is not the only way to elevate the food. The primary way to elevate the food is by using the energy that is, you've been taken in by the food to do good. Benching is one way of starting that process, of recognizing that the food comes from God. And that will certainly ease the transfer from physical eating to spiritualizing that energy. But that's not the only way. That's not the only way. Yeah?
Just two things. One, I was thinking before you said that some people are exempt. I was wondering where, people with mental illness and things like that fit into that category.
Okay, the Talmud talks about that. Yeah. The Talmud talks about somebody who is incapable of making choice, who due to mental illness, is incapable of controlling making moral choices, and such a person is exempt from the laws, cannot be held culpable.
And just one other thing, in relation to, sorry, I don't know what your name is,
but
Tracy, was mentioning about the food. From what you said before, what I got from it was that you were comparing the tzaddik with the rashi, in the sense that the tzaddik, rasha, that the tzaddik infused with holiness that even the physical process of eating was almost repulsive because it was actually feeding the physical soul.
Not that eating is repulsive, that indulging in eating would be repulsive. Being physical in a materialistic way would be repulsive, but the tzaddik eats to have the energy to do good.
Yeah.
And so eating is not innately repulsive. It can be a very holy act.
But then in contrast, the rasha is eating with the intent of doing wrong.
Or even just selfishly eating. Just indulgently
eating.
Yeah.
So that's like a contrast between the two, and that's where the food, it's not so much a ritual where you're eating and you have to imbue it with holiness or anything like that. It's more like a contrast between the two.
Correct. So within the categories of a rasha, within those who are indeed evil, there is, however, a rasha who intermittently suffers remorse, regret, feels bad for the wrong that they've done, which means that they recognize they've done something immoral. They haven't been straight, they haven't been honest, they haven't been upright, they haven't done the right thing. They know it, they recognize it, and they feel remorse, they feel regret for it. It bothers them, and thoughts of repentance enter his mind. But he says, I've really got to change. I've got to stop this. I know it's wrong, and I've got to do something about it. And so they make some feeble attempt to change themselves that often goes nowhere, and they end up going back to the same wrong, the same immorality, the same mistake, but again, in between, feeling bad about it. So the problem is that the thoughts of repentance pop into his mind, and that thought of repentance comes from the good quality, the divine soul that is still alive and kicking there, that's still crying out and saying, you've got to change. Even somebody, this could be somebody who does serious sins, does really bad stuff, and does it often, but nevertheless, this pang of conscience arises in their soul that they don't want to be doing this. But they're so entrenched, they're so stuck in their bad habits, that they fall back into it constantly and regret it again.
Shouldn't it be that when they try to make a change and when they, in the beginning, when you're inspired or whatever to make a change and you act on it, shouldn't that help them from getting stuck back into it? Like, shouldn't it give them strength to not get stuck back into it?
We're talking about somebody who it doesn't.
Right.
We're talking. This is a case study. This is an example of a person. This is a level. Yeah. A level of a rasha. A rasha, a wicked person who does wicked. Maybe it's once a month, once a year, or once a day. And they regret it after. They wish they didn't do it. But they keep falling back. And they do it again.
Right. So it's just
so
regret.
So they have sincere thoughts of repentance. And they may even start making moves to try and do something about it. But they keep falling back down.
Right.
That's what we're talking about here. Somebody who successfully repents, somebody who does the wrong thing, realizes and makes amends, actually changes their ways. So they have gone out of the category of a Rasha. They're not a Rasha anymore.
Sorry, I'm just confused, because if someone has sincere thoughts of repentance and makes moves to change, but can't, shouldn't he receive help from Hashem? Like, if it's, isn't that Shuvah in itself, if you have sincere thoughts of repentance?
Should he receive help from Hashem? He is. That thought is help from Hashem. That's where it came from. And definitely, every person has free choice. Every person who is of sound mind still has free choice. But the problem is, when you have strengthened your animalistic side, the evil side, by reinforcing it, by doing it over and over again, that habit is very difficult to break. Impossible? No, it's not impossible. It's possible. But that's going to take a huge amount of effort, and the opportunity is definitely going to be given.
Right.
That it does say in the Talmud, it says that somebody who tries to change will be given the opportunity to. And the end will be their choice, whether they are willing to do the hard work or fall back into it. So we're not saying here that this is a person who is cursed to constantly go back to their evil ways. We're saying this is what they're doing.
They've chosen it.
In the end, they are choosing it. They haven't made the resolve enough to change their ways. But they are regretting it. They're regretting it over and over again. And that regret counts for something. That means something. That means that there is a soul still alive there. There is a divine element that is coming and regretting this. So this is a level. This is a wicked person, but it's a wicked person with regrets. The problem is, however, he has not enough strength to vanquish the evil so as to rid himself entirely of his sins and abandon his evil ways once and for all. He just doesn't have the strength to stick with it. He has the regret, but he can't just change his ways. He can't do it. He doesn't have the strength. His divine soul is this weak voice that has been ignored for too long. And so it's just not winning the battle. Concerning such a person, the rabbis of the Talmud of blessed memory said, the wicked are full of regrets. This is a compliment. That there's a certain type of wicked person in Russia who is full of regrets. Meaning they're constantly regretting stuff because they're constantly doing it. They're falling back into it. And they're regretting it over and over again. But it's not moving further. It's not a regret that leads to change. They're too steeped in it. And this, says Tanya, this represents the majority of wicked people. The majority of wicked people whose soul still lingers some good. That there's some good that still lingers on in their soul. Which means that most wicked people, most of the time when we talk about a Rasha, we're talking about somebody who does have goodness still in their soul. That they're not completely devoid of any good. Their divine soul has not completely gone asleep. It's still there. There's good in them, and they have these regrets. And therefore there is hope for them that one day that good spark will light up into a flame, that they will find this inner strength to change, that somebody will help them and inspire them, or they'll call out for help and find the right help. They may not be able to help themselves. They may be in a state where they are too deep in it to help themselves, but if they really want help, they'll call out for somebody else, and somebody else can help them. And so therefore, there is certainly hope for such a person.
That's believing in someone.
Right.
Someone needs to believe in it.
Correct. Correct.
And they might not be searching.
But they also need to call out. You can believe in them from today till tomorrow, but if they don't look for help, so then they're going to be stuck. And it's always a two-way thing. Something has to awaken within them. That there has to be some move within them to reach out. So there also has to be somebody who always believes in them. Because that will hold them in that place of potential, of possibility of moving out of it. There's always two ways. This is the majority of wicked people, says Tanya. Most people who are wicked are in this category, full of regrets. But there's another category. He who never feels contrition, and in whose mind no thoughts of repentance at all ever enter, is called the wicked who suffers. That's called Rasha Varalo in Hebrew, a wicked person who just has it bad. For the evil that is in his soul is all that he has left. having so prevailed over the good that it has already departed from within him, standing aloof, so to speak, over him. Therefore, the sages have said, over every gathering of 10 hovers the Shekhinah, the divine presence. Here, what Rabbi Shneur Zalman here is saying is that there's a lower level of a Rasha, somebody who has no regrets. They don't have any remorse. They don't feel bad about anything they've done. They stick with it. They stand by it. They don't feel they need to change. They're quite satisfied with who they are. They, of course, wouldn't see themselves as a Rasha, as a wicked person at all. The evil that they've done, they justify. They're comfortable with it completely. About such a person, why are they not having any regrets? If the previous one we spoke about, the let's call him the incomplete Rasha, the Rasha who has regrets, where do those regrets come from? From the divine soul that is still pulsating, that is still alive. There's still a conscience there. There's still a sense of, I'm doing something wrong. So therefore they have regrets. They feel bad about what they've done. It's not strong enough to change them. Their regrets are not strong enough to make them actually make a move, but they feel it. They at least feel it. Here we're talking about a Rasha who doesn't even have regrets, who doesn't feel any remorse. What does that indicate about their divine soul? It's dead, or it's dormant, or it's departed, or it's silenced, it's buried, it's ineffectual. There's no effect, there's no sign of it. Remember when we spoke about the tzaddik? We said the tzaddik who is actually revolted by evil means that their animal soul has completely been vanquished, been turned around. Whereas a tzaddik who is not revolted by evil, it means that there is still some animalistic, selfish urge left in them, just it never manifests in any real way, except for the fact that they're not revolted by evil. They're still not tempted by it. Here, it's the other way around. A wicked person who has regrets means that their divine soul is still alive, it's still beating, and that's why they have regrets. Not strong enough to change their life, not to actually impact their behavior, but it's still there. Whereas a complete Rasha is somebody where their divine soul is so silenced that it doesn't even ring a bell of conscience. It doesn't even protest. There's no sign of it. It doesn't manifest in any way. So that they have no regrets about the evil that they do. Even so, says Rabbi Shneur Zalman, it doesn't mean that their divine soul is dead or absent or gone. It means that the divine soul is aloof, is what's called in Hebrew makif, which means it's floating around them. It's not in them. It's not internalized in them. It's surrounding them. It's like in the background, not in the foreground. It's not asserting itself. It's got no voice, but it's still there. Because a divine soul cannot be completely eradicated, but it just has no place. It can't rest in their personality, so it floats above them. This he quotes from the Talmud. The sages say that over every gathering of 10 hovers the Shekhinah, the divine presence. There's an idea that when 10 people get together to do anything, this is not just a minyan in shul, this is talking about any time 10 people get together, like we are together studying Torah now, there is a certain energy that the divine presence rests with those 10 people. There's a certain holiness when you do something, when you do a mitzvah with 10 people, there's an extra divine energy called the Shekhinah, the divine presence, that rests, that hovers above that group. The language used is that over every gathering of 10 hovers the Shekhinah. Why is it that? Because there's no requirements as to who those 10 should be. If 10 wicked people, 10 Rishoyim, wicked people, even completely wicked people who have no regrets, if they got together and studied Torah or said some prayers together or did a charitable act, wicked people can do mitzvahs as well. They're not always sinning. They can do something positive and good. If 10 of them get together, the divine presence hovers there as well. But it hovers over them. It's not internalized by them. It's not revealed in their personality, because their personality is so thoroughly evil, they have no regrets for the evil that they've done, that even the good that they do is still good.
but it's floating. It hasn't landed. It's not a part of them. And so you can have wicked people who do a lot of good, but the good that they do somehow does not infuse their personality, doesn't influence them positively to change them. They still remain wicked and regretless about their wicked. They have no regrets about it. Unrepentant, even though they're doing good, because the good doesn't rest in them, it floats above them, it hovers around them. So it's still there. The divine soul is always still there, but it's hovering. It's no longer inside. It hasn't got a place, it hasn't got a landing, it hasn't got a home inside of their personality. And that is the complete Russia.
They don't recognize that they do evil.
It's very rare for somebody to say, I'm an evil person, I do evil, I just think evil is good, or evil is okay. Very rare. Usually somebody who is evil justifies their evil to explain why it's the best thing in the world. Mm-hmm. And it's the right thing to do.
Do you ever, work for someone who has not regretted an evil act? And you have to counsel them for the evil act that they don't regret. It has to be very hard.
Because what are you counseling? What are you trying to help me for? Like, what I've done no wrong. There's nothing to hold on to. If there's a sense of remorse, then there's something there. But if there's not even that, there's very little to work with there. It's very hard.
With the Sadiq, you're saying that, you know, the two chambers of the heart, that the good can overcome the evil and can actually start to overwhelm the evil to become good. But in contrast, that Russia can, the goodness can't be vanquished. So it hovers above.
Correct. While the negative side of the heart, the selfish side of the heart, can be turned around, can be transformed. Because after all, the animal soul wants us to vanquish it. Like the metaphor of the prince and the prostitute that we learned a couple of weeks ago, the animal soul wants to be beaten. So really, the animal soul can be turned around because its real nature is to be a part of the divine soul's game. But the divine soul can never be vanquished, truly. It can be banished. It can be sent to the outer recesses. It can be sent to hover away, but it can never be truly turned around, because the divine is indestructible. It can't be really beaten. So there's always an edge. The divine will always have an edge over the animal soul in that way. But still, this Russia Rerale, the wicked who suffers, the completely wicked person, is in a very bad state, very difficult to reach, to break through to, because there's nothing to work with. But like we said before, this is less common. This is not the average Russia. The average Russia is a Russia full of regrets. This is one that has no regrets whatsoever. That's a rare breed.
I have two questions. I think one might be similar to Keshet's, which is that how does a complete Russia, how are they expected to do Teshuvah if the holiness doesn't strengthen him, because it doesn't actually get inside them?
Okay. How can a complete Russia do tshuva? So it's going to take much more for them to change. It's going to take a complete transformation. It's not like normal tshuva is a sort of turnaround in the heart. For a Russia, it's a complete reinvention. They're going to have to break a hole open in the thick layers that are covering over their soul, that are not allowing the divine soul to rest, and they're going to have to start again. So it's going to take a certain shattering, that their life is going to have to hit rock bottom, and they have to completely rebuild themselves. It'll take something quite dramatic to turn around a Russia. But again, they'll be given those opportunities. Those voices will come from the outside, not inside. They have no internal voice at the moment.
Yeah.
A conscience telling them that they're doing wrong. But there'll be messages from the outside telling them they're doing something wrong. But still, they have to choose to listen to that and say, I need to get out of this.
Another question is that, where do you classify someone, and is this even a Russia? If someone is searching and finds meaning and I guess temporary satisfaction or satisfaction in different religions, and goes between them with regret, oh, I don't like what I've done, and then goes to another one, but never actually comes to Judaism or hasn't yet, and they're a Jewish person, is that a level of Rasha, or what is that?
No. As we're going to see, that somebody who has not been exposed to the Jewish way, or even if they have, but they haven't been exposed to it in a way that's positive and connects to them, so then they cannot be held responsible for their lack of connection. That's not a Rasha. A Rasha is somebody who knows what they're doing and they rebel. It has to be clear. Yeah.
What is the statistic in society of these types of Rashas? And do you believe that Hashem puts obstacles in their way or gives them hard times so that they can wake up from their state?
Okay, look, the statistics I don't know. I can't say. But Tanya says that they're the minority of Rashaim. That's not the majority. So we're not talking about a lot of people in the general scheme of things. But exact statistics, I have no idea. But do they get opportunities to repent? Absolutely they do. They do get those opportunities. They're sent those opportunities, but they have to be open to it. It's not going to be easy for them either. If somebody has dug their heels in their evil ways, that they've actually got to this point where they probably were at one stage the wicked person with regrets. They did have regrets at some stage, and they allowed themselves to ignore that so many times to the point where they have completely anesthetized themselves from any conscience. So when you've dug your heels in that far, it's not going to be easy for you to come back. But the opportunity will be presented. Absolutely.
Do you think that these Russia people get given, say, tragedies in their life to deal with that another person may not get because of their behavior?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily will the Russia have worse things happen to them than the Tzaddik. That's not the way this world works. We see completely innocent and righteous people suffer horribly, and we see total wicked people seem to flourish and thrive and have no major issues, it seems. So not necessarily is that the way. But opportunities will come, whether it be through great difficulties or great blessings in their life or whatever it is, we don't know. Yeah.
What about drugs? What about someone who's deeply addicted to drugs and they've become so overwhelmed and controlled by drugs?
Look, that's another example of somebody who cannot help themselves. They need outside help. But that is a metaphor for this as well. That evil and immorality can be compared to a drug addiction. That it starts off with choice, but the choice slowly slips away and you become controlled by it. Immorality, all immorality is the same thing. And there's a certain point where you cannot fix it yourself. You need outside help. So that's the two levels of a Rasha. The Rasha that is incomplete, that has regrets, and the Rasha that is so beyond that they don't even regret it anymore. It doesn't bother them. We can compare them and contrast the Tzaddik and the Rasha now. In the previous chapters, we learned where the two levels of Tzaddik are. Now we've learned two levels of Rasha. The two levels of Tzaddik are the incomplete Tzaddik, still has some affinity to evil. Not they do evil. Not they're tempted to do evil, but because they're not disgusted by it, therefore there is some connection. The animal soul is not completely transformed. Whereas a complete tzaddik is so disgusted by evil, it's so off-putting to them, they don't have any of it in them, so therefore they have no attraction to it. Not just they wouldn't do it, for sure not. Not just they would not attempt to do it, also not. They're not even able to tolerate evil. It disgusts them. That's a complete tzaddik. A Rasha also has an incomplete and a complete version. The incomplete Rasha is full of regrets. Their divine soul is still alive. So therefore, even though they do the wrong thing, and they may repeatedly do the wrong thing, but they regret it. It bothers them. It makes them upset. Not enough to change. Whereas a complete Rasha shows no remorse. They have no regret. It doesn't bother them whatsoever. Let's just for fun now meet one of each of these types of Rasha. Two types of Rasha. This guy, his name is Joseph Paul Franklin. And he's a self-confessed neo-Nazi who had a pathological hatred of blacks, Jews, and interracial couples. Joseph Paul Franklin is scheduled to die by lethal injection at 12:01 a.m. on Wednesday this week. For the sniper killing of 42-year-old Gerald Gordon outside a bar mitzvah at a suburban St. Louis synagogue in 1977. So this guy, Joseph Paul Franklin, he went outside a synagogue, waited for people to come out, and randomly shot a 42-year-old man just in the street outside a synagogue in 1977. Franklin was also convicted of killing an interracial couple in Madison, Wisconsin in 1977, two black joggers in Salt Lake City in 1980, and two teenage boys, and bombing a synagogue in Chattanooga, Tennessee in 1977. These are all the things that he's been convicted of. In what is possibly his last interview before his execution on Wednesday this week in Missouri, Franklin has admitted to killing 22 people, 17 more murders than he's been convicted of. So he's only been convicted of 5, he's admitted to another 17. Confirming that he was responsible for the cold-blooded execution-style deaths of approximately, he says, 22 people, Franklin showed sparse remorse as he attempted to justify his killings. I figured once I started doing it and showed them how, other white supremacists would do the same thing. He was trying to lead by example. This is what he's saying this week, a few days before his execution. So this is not somebody who has changed in any way or regrets in any way what he's done. He totally stands by what he's done. He's proud of it. That's how he feels. This is an unremorseful, unregretful Russia. No question at all. And he's going to die this week by lethal injection. So it's a separate debate about the death penalty. That's not for here. I'd be fascinated to hear the arguments against the death penalty in this case. Anyway, this is where we see a Russia Gomer, a complete Russia, somebody who is entrenched in evil. This guy, his name is David Berkowitz. He was also interviewed recently. David Berkowitz, who shot 13 people in cold blood, killing 6 in a 13-month shooting spree in late 70s, spoke to the Daily News in an exclusive interview from jail. It's all senseless, says Berkowitz, who is serving 6 25 years to life sentences at maximum security Sullivan County Correctional Facility in upstate New York. Now 59, Berkowitz no longer has his devilish smirk that riveted readers after his arrest in 1977. You can't quite see it there, but he was quite self-righteous about what he did back then. He doesn't have that anymore. He also says he rejects violence, lamenting the recent shootings in Colorado and Wisconsin. I would love to speak bluntly to those teens and wannabes and tell them prison is nothing like what you think. If you're packing a gun, you're making a big mistake and you'll regret it. I think it's a big tragedy when I see young men with their macho faces like they're cool when I know they're really scared to death, he says. I know because I've been there. So he wants to speak to the world, speak to these youth and tell them, get out of these violent gangs, don't be a part of it. Berkowitz says he doesn't like to talk about the dark days when his shootings were splashed on the front of New York tabloids. It's too painful, Berkowitz tells the paper. I continue to pray for the victims of my crimes. I do wish them the best in life, but I'm sure the pain will never end for them. I regret that. I have regrets more than words can say, he tells the reporter. I have regrets about all the people I hurt, about what my life would have been like. I've missed out on a lot, but God has given me peace about my situation. So says David Berkowitz. So here's a person who is a Russia. He killed 6 people, there's no question, but he regrets it. So does he deserve any different treatment to somebody who doesn't regret it? That's a different discussion. From a Jewish point of view, the punishment is on the act, not on the feeling. But in your relationship with God, that is dependent on your feeling. There's no way that you can return the evil that he's done. He can't reverse it. There's nothing he can do to bring the people who he killed back to life. Nothing. But in his relationship with God, in the way he stands before God, he regrets what he's done and he has made an internal change. Whether that means he should be freed on the street, whether that means that if he could get the death penalty, he shouldn't get the death penalty, that's a different discussion. We're not even talking about that. We're not saying that he's left the category of Russia, that we don't know. But that he regrets what he did, that he's saying, that's he's expressing. We can take his word for it. So we do feel differently towards this guy, as opposed to the first guy, somebody who is unrepentant in the murder that he's done, as opposed to somebody who is repentant about it, our feelings are slightly different towards them. Even though both of them are cold-blooded murderers, but one of them is a Rasha V'Tovloi, a wicked person, that there is some sense of goodness, that even if it's just words that he's saying, even if this Berkovitz is not sincere about his regret, maybe he's not all that sincere, but that the fact that he can say it means that there's some decency left in him, there's something there. Whereas somebody who has no regrets about the evil that they've done, there's nothing to work with, there's nothing to build on, there's nothing that can grow, that can flourish from such a person in their current state. He would have to be totally reinvented to begin again, to begin their life again. So these are two extreme examples of a wicked person with regrets and a wicked person with no regrets, the two levels of wicked. However, as I said earlier, we're here to study Tanya to find ourselves in this. And looking around, I don't see too many cold-blooded murderers studying Tanya this evening. They don't come back, I find. But nevertheless, we can find within ourselves these two levels of Russia as well. The Russia that has regrets and the Russia that has no regrets. The areas in our life where we do that which is immoral and we feel bad about it. We feel bad, but we still do it. And then there's areas where we do something we know is wrong, but we don't feel bad. We justify it. We say it's not so bad. It's not all that wrong. It's not evil at all. These are the two levels. When you do one often enough, you become that level. When you constantly do evil to the point where you feel bad about nothing, that's when you've become the category of a complete Russia. Whereas if you have regrets, if there's still things that you regret, even if not everything, so then you're in the category of an incomplete Russia. You haven't got completeness in wickedness, which is good news. So this is chapter 11. And chapter 11, as I said, is a brief chapter introducing to us the two levels of Russia. I want to go immediately into chapter 12. I don't want to leave us with chapter 11. Because chapter 12 introduces the next stage. You can't study the Russia and leave it there. We have to look into the next stage as well. Until now, by seeing the tzaddik and seeing the Russia, we've seen two very extreme personalities. The tzaddik does no evil and is not tempted to do evil. The Russia is constantly doing evil, either regretting it or not even regretting it. We're talking about two very extreme personalities. Now, so far, if you've been scoring yourself, trying to rate yourself on the scheme of things, so most of us would have said, well, the tzaddik is way too high for me. I can't say I'm a tzaddik that only does good and is never tempted to do anything wrong. Can't say that. So what does that leave me? As a Russia, because I'm certainly tempted to do the wrong thing. And not only that, but I have done the wrong thing and I have done immoral things. I've done things that I wasn't supposed to do. And some of them I don't even regret. I don't even feel so bad about it. So I'm maybe not a complete Russia. I do have some regrets. But in some areas of my life, I am like the complete Russia in that particular area. That's where I'm left. If that's what I am, and being a tzaddik is so far away, so then what hope do I have? What am I supposed to do? What's expected of me? What else could I possibly be? This is where Tanya comes with a revolutionary idea, which is not really discussed anywhere else until the book of Tanya. And that is that Rabbi Shneur Zalman introduces what's called the Beinoni. Beinoni is a term that's been used in Talmudic and pre-Talmudic times as meaning the intermediate person. But Rabbi Shneur Zalman gives a completely new meaning of the word Beinoni. Beinoni is the possible man, is a level that is not a tzaddik, but is not a Rasha. That you're not completely righteous, but you're not a wicked person. It's a possible, realistic level that we can actually strive for. That is what it is. Let's see what he's talking about. The intermediate man, the Beinoni, is he in whom evil never attains enough power to capture the small city so as to clothe itself in the body and make it sin. That is to say, the three garments of the animal soul, thought, speech, and action, do not prevail within him over the divine soul to the extent of clothing themselves in the body and causing him to sin. Meaning, a Beinoni, first and foremost, is somebody who the animal soul never takes control of your body or the garments of your soul, the thought, speech, and action, never controls your behavior to sin. A Beinoni is somebody who does not sin. Only the three garments of the divine soul, and they alone control the body, being the thought, speech, and action of the 613 commandments of the Torah. He has never committed nor never will commit any transgression, neither can the name wicked be applied to him even temporarily or even for a moment throughout his life. Sound realistic? Not yet. That somebody who will always do the right thing, all of the garments of their souls, thought, speech, and action, will do the 613 commandments of the Torah. Meaning that their behavior is always righteous, is always good. They're always doing the right thing. They've never committed or ever will commit any transgression. Now hang on a minute. That's question number one. Why is that different to a tzaddik? We'll see soon. Second of all, I just said a minute ago that this is the possible man. This is realistic. This is something that we can be. If you have ever transgressed a sin, it's too late. It says here that you never committed, nor never will commit. That you've got a totally clean slate of never committing a sin. If I've ever committed a sin, I'm out of this category already. You can't even temporarily be applied the term wicked throughout your life. How am I supposed to do that? It's too late. I've been wicked. I've committed sins. I've even committed sins and not regretted them. How can I claim to be on this level? What Rabbi Shneur Zalman here means is not that chronologically there's never been a sin in your record, that your record is totally clean. What he means is that it's never been left there, that you have never committed a sin that you haven't repented for, that you haven't made amends, that you haven't turned around and done tshuva, done a cleansing for. Because we know that when you cleanse, when you have real regret, remorse, and you do something to change, not just a feeling of remorse, but you actually move away from that sin, so then the sin is wiped clean as if it was never there. And so a Beinoni is not somebody who never ever sinned. It's somebody who never left a sin unfixed, never left it dangling, that they have dealt with any negativity that they've done, and they have repented for it. They've turned themselves around. There's no unfinished business in their moral life. This is a Beinoni. How is this not a tzaddik? We'll see in a minute. A Beinoni never sins, so why isn't that a tzaddik? If a Beinoni never sinned, never did sin, has cleansed everything, has a totally clean slate, why is this not a tzaddik? How are they different to a tzaddik? Says Rabbi Shneur Zalman. However, the essence and being of the divine soul, which are its 10 faculties, remember the intellect and the emotion of the divine soul, do not constantly hold undisputed sovereignty and sway over the small city, except at particular times, such as during the recital of the Shema, the prayers, or Amidah. But after prayer, when the elevated state departs, the evil in the left part reawakens, and he begins to feel a desire for the lusts of the world and its delights. Meaning, the difference between the Beinoni and the Tzaddik is that while both of them will not do anything wrong, their behavior is totally in the hands of the divine soul, but the difference is their inner world. As far as their desires, as far as what's lying in their heart, they're very different. The tzaddik has no temptation to do evil, has no desire to do evil. It will never cross their mind to do something wrong. The Beinoni, it most certainly might. They will feel the desire, the urge to do something immoral, to do that something selfish and animalistic. The urge will be there. They will just not act on that urge. In behavior, they're the same as a tzaddik. In their inner world, they're very, very different. In fact, they're the same as a rasha. They'll have the same temptations as a wicked person. This is the Beinoni, a new character of person. While they're praying, when they're in the middle of saying the Shema, when they're sitting in shul, then they're actually quite like a tzaddik, because their heart is pure, is connected to God, and at that moment they wouldn't imagine sinning. The problem is when they go home afterwards, when they finish praying and they leave that space, then their negative side can reawaken just like before, just like a rasha, just like an evil person. They can be tempted to do the wrong thing. It is absolutely there. The divine soul does not have control over their 10 faculties, over their intellect and emotion. The divine soul has absolute control over their three garments, thought, speech, and action, behavior, but not over personality, over what pops into their mind or what comes into their heart. That the divine soul does not have dominion over in a Benini. Yet, because the evil has not the soul authority and dominion over the city, it is unable to carry out this desire from the potential into the actual by clothing itself in the bodily limbs, indeed, speech and persistent thought, to the extent of concentrating his attention on the enjoyment of the mundane pleasures as to how to satisfy the lust of his heart. Because the brain rules over the heart by virtue of its innately created nature. Again, that even though an urge to do something evil will arise in the mind and the heart of a Benini, because the animal soul does have footing in their personality, in their heart and their mind, but the animal soul does not have the only control. The divine soul is so strong in them, is so persistent in the Benini, that it will not allow the desire to be actualized. That an urge to do the wrong thing will never be fulfilled in a Benini. He will control himself to not do it. Because the mind controls the heart by nature, as we studied earlier in Tanya, that the mind is able to control the heart's desires. And so as long as the divine soul has a clear voice in the mind, it can hold the heart's desires at bay and not allow them to be expressed in behavior. This is the Benini. The Benini has total control over their behavior. They can't control their feelings, but their feelings do not dictate what they do. Their mind dictates what they do, and their mind is filled with the divine soul's perspective and therefore is able to control behavior. So they can't control every thought that pops into their head, but they can control whether they maintain that thought in their head or discard it. That they can totally control. They can't control every urge, every impulse that comes up. Some impulses will be negative, but they do control whether they entertain that impulse or they reject it. It's totally in their hands. A person with total self-control, that is what a Benini is. For this is how man is created from birth, that each person may, with the willpower in his brain, restrain himself and control the drive of lust that is in his heart, preventing his heart's desires from expressing themselves in action, word, or thought, and divert his attention altogether from the craving of his heart toward the completely opposite direction, particularly in the direction of holiness. That we have this power, we all have this power. Whether we use it or not is a different discussion. But the power to control our urges and to behave right, even if we don't feel like it, that's in our hands. We're born with that power. It's a willpower in the brain to do what we know is right, even if our heart is lusting for something else. Just out of interest, I came across, this is from Forbes magazine, an article that listed the six secrets of self-control. The six secrets of self-control, written by a non-Jewish secular writer, this is not a religious text, but in Forbes magazine it lists the six secrets of self-control are meditate, eat, exercise, sleep, ride the wave, and forgive yourself. Which means, meditate, he says here, is having control of your mind. This is number one secret of self-control. You have to have control of your mind. Meditating, any form of meditating, is controlling your thoughts, being in charge of what comes into your mind. And Jewish meditation and prayer is exactly that as well. Focusing on the prayer and not letting extraneous thoughts come, controlling your mind. If you are controlling your mind, that's the first secret to self-control. Because your mind decides what you're going to do. Your heart may desire something else, but your mind can override it. Eating, he says, that you have to eat well and eat healthily. That if you're not eating the right foods, so then your mind doesn't function properly. You don't think straight, and so therefore you can't control yourself. So to exercise and sleep, that these are necessary for your mind to function correctly. You can only think clearly if you're fit, if your juices are circulating well, and sleep as well. If you're overtired, then you're not thinking straight, and your decision making is skewed. You're not able to control yourself. And then the last two, ride the wave, means that an urge pops up and wants to be fulfilled immediately. If you ride the wave, meaning say, okay, let's just wait 10 minutes. And then see how we feel then. Instead of responding to an urge, just ride the way. Let the urge take its course, but give it a bit of 10 minutes. If you delay it, 10 minutes is usually enough for the urge not to be so urgent, and your mind to say, I don't really need to do this. I don't want to do this. When you're trying to control yourself, let the urge express itself, but don't follow it. Give it 10 minutes. Ride the wave. And then forgive yourself if you do the wrong thing. You can regret it, but forgive yourself. Don't beat yourself up on it. Because because beating yourself up and saying that you're useless will make you give in to further urges. So you have to, even if you failed, to get back up and not to look down at yourself. This is from Forbes magazine, but certainly from Tanya, we would agree that these things are certainly helpful in self-control, because the mind is the determining factor. That if you've got a strong mind that knows what's right and is thinking clearly, is well-fed and well-rested and well-exercised, so then you will be able to control your urges much better than somebody who has never exercised their brain to determine to be in control, and who is overtired, unfit, and undernourished. That is what self-control is, which Rabbi Shneur Zalman says, this is not a spiritual thing, this is our nature. Our nature is that the mind decides what we do. We're born that way. We just lose it because we don't exercise it. We don't exercise that, we just follow our urges. We follow whatever impulse, whatever instinct comes up. The mind is able to control the heart and direct us. And in a Beinoni, the Beinoni has perfected this. The Beinoni has this to a T, where every single move they make is the divine soul's desire, even though the animal soul is screaming out with animalistic and selfish and immoral urges. The Beinoni says, that's nice, that's not what I'm doing. You can want that, that's not what I'm following. You can have the urge, doesn't mean you have to do it. The Beinoni has this to perfection. But it's still not a tzaddik. Such a person is still not a tzaddik. Not a tzaddik at all. For in the intermediate man, the Beinoni, the essence and being of the animal soul remains entirely intact after they've prayed. When they're not in a state of prayer, when they're not in a state of inspiration, their animal soul is totally strong. For then the burning love of God is not in a revealed state in his heart, in the right part of the heart, but is only inwardly paved with hidden love. That is the natural adoration in the divine soul, as will be explained later. Later in Tanya, we're going to go into this in more depth, of the various different levels of love that exist in our heart for God and for goodness. There's a revealed love that is passionate, and then there's a hidden love, which is not all that passionate. For the Beinoni, when they're praying, when they're in spiritual connectedness, then they feel a love of God. But there are certain... But after they prayed, they don't feel it at all. Their heart could be filled with physical desires. They are not in any way like a tzaddik. A tzaddik is like somebody who's praying all day, who's always connected. A Beinoni is not. When they're in the mode, they're in. And then when they're out, they're out. Their heart can be full of selfish desires. Therefore, it is possible for the folly of the wicked fool, which is the evil inclination, the animal soul, to rise openly in the left part of his heart, creating a lust for all material things of this world, whether permitted or, God forbid, prohibited, as if he had not prayed at all. That while he's praying, he wouldn't dream of doing this, but as soon as he's finished the prayers and walks out, any desire could come to a Beinoni, any permitted desires to just eat a nice kosher breakfast, or the most forbidden, ugly desire of doing a terrible sin. Nevertheless, in regard to a forbidden matter, it does not occur to him to actually violate the prohibition, God forbid. And it remains in the realm of sinful thoughts, which can be forceful enough to rise to his mind, to distract him from the Torah and divine service, but not do anything about it. To do something forbidden could arise in his mind, but he will never follow such a thing because he can bang it down straight away. He can control it straight away. I'm not going in that path at all. So therefore, the Beinoni is not a tzaddik. A tzaddik would never even have the desire to do such a thing. The Beinoni does, but controls it. But no sooner does it reach there, as soon as the desire reaches his mind, than he thrusts it out with both hands and averts his mind from it the instant he reminds himself that it is an evil thought, refusing to accept it willingly, even to let his thoughts play on it willingly. How much more so to entertain any idea of putting it into effect, God forbid, for he who willfully indulges in such thoughts is deemed wicked at such a time, whereas the intermediate person is never wicked for a single moment. That if it pops into your head, you can't always help that. But if you entertain the thought, that was in your control already. A wicked person is not just somebody who does evil, somebody who fantasizes about doing evil, who entertains the thought. A Beinoni would never even do that. And so while the thought can pop in his head, he pushes it away with two hands. As soon as he recognizes this is an evil thought, it's gone. It's banished. So too in relations with his neighbor. This is a powerful idea. And this is the end of this chapter. That even in relations with a fellow human being, as soon as there arises from his heart to his mind some animosity or hatred, God forbid, or jealousy or anger or a grudge and such like, he gives them no entrance into his mind and will. On the contrary, his mind exercises its authority and power over the spirit in his heart to do the very opposite and to conduct himself towards his neighbor with the quality of kindness and a display of abundant love without becoming provoked into anger, God forbid, or to revenge in kind, God forbid, but rather to repay the offenders with favors, as taught in the Zohar, that one should learn from the example of Joseph towards his brothers. Joseph in the Torah was sold by his brothers into slavery. His very brothers sold him into slavery. And he ended up the viceroy of Egypt. When his brothers met him, not only didn't take revenge against the brothers who harmed him, but he embraced them and he looked after them and he had no ill feeling to them whatsoever. That is a Beinoni. A Beinoni will not necessarily never entertain a thought of anger or jealousy or retribution or revenge against another person. That thought could pop into their mind. But as soon as it lands, they will reject it immediately. They will never continue the thought. See, many of us are nothing like those horrible monsters that we showed earlier, these murderers. Many of us would never even come close to doing such a horrible thing. It's completely unimaginable. However, we have to be honest that sometimes we do get frustrated. Sometimes we do get angry at somebody. Sometimes somebody really gets under our skin for good reason. They could have really seriously hurt us. They could have done something terribly wrong. They could have horribly harmed us or somebody else. And we do get angry at that person. And while we will not actually go and do something to that person, but to entertain the thought of something happening to that person, maybe. Maybe we could. Even a Beinoni could have such a thought that of doing something, of getting back at somebody for a horrible evil that they've done. Even a Beinoni could have such a thought. But a Beinoni would never continue that thought, would never entertain it, would never indulge in the thought. Somebody else may say, look, it doesn't hurt just imagining hurting such a person, imagining them suffering. I'm not going to do it. The Beinoni would not even enjoy the thought of it. It would pop into their head and they would reject it immediately. And the Beinoni would say that even to somebody who's hurt me, that's their problem. It's not my problem. To them, I will be good. If I can do them a favor, I'll do them a favor. If I can help them become a better person, I'll help them become a better person. But I will not go out to hurt them. Justice is a different thing. The justice should be done. If somebody's committed a crime or a horrible hurt on somebody, that they should suffer the consequences, that's a different thing. That's for their good as well. But simply to take revenge, to be angry, to be vengeful towards them, to have hatred towards them, that a Beinoni has no time for. A negative feeling like that could pop into their minds, could pop into their heart, and then they push it away immediately because they have total control over their behavior. And behavior is not just doing, behavior is also thinking, deliberate thinking. A thought can pop into my head, I didn't control that. But to entertain it, to continue that thought, that's in my hands. The Beinoni will not allow such a thing to remain in their mind for more than an instant. This, says Rabbi Shneur Zalman, is the possible man. This is the level that we who are not a tzaddik, and we who maybe have been a rasha, can strive to be a Beinoni. This is a new category where you're far from perfection. You're nowhere near getting it right all the time. But as far as your behavior is concerned, it's totally in your hands. That is totally up to you. And it's this Beinoni that we need to get to know better. And we will get to know better in the next few chapters. Rabbi Shneur Zalman spends much more time than he did on a tzaddik or certainly on a rasha. He's going to spend a few good chapters on understanding who this Beinoni is. I once met a Beinoni. His name is Rabbi Moshe Weber from Jerusalem. He passed away in the year 2000. And the Rebbe himself identified him as being a Beinoni. He was a student and a follower of the Rebbe, and he was an amazing character. He lived in a very small little apartment in the middle of Mea Shearim in Jerusalem, and he was known as one of the warmest and most inviting people. Anytime there was any straggler found in the community, everyone said, "Oh, you need to go to Rabbi Moshe Weber. Go to his house for Shabbos. Go to his table." He had an open home, and I used to sometimes visit him on Friday nights. I didn't eat meals at his house, but after the meal, I would go to his home. You just walked in the door. You didn't need an invitation, and there'd be people streaming in all the time. Him and his wife were not blessed with children. However, they were such parents to so many thousands of people in Jerusalem. Anyone who went to Jerusalem ended up sometime in his home. He's also the one who started the tefillin booth at the Kotel, at the Western Wall, putting on tefillin after the Six-Day War when the Western Wall was reconquered. He went himself and on a daily basis would offer people to put on tefillin as they came down. And he started the tefillin booth, which is still there today, which has put on millions of pairs of tefillin over the years. He's the one who started it. I remember whenever I would go to his house, he would always ask me my name. He didn't remember me. And I'd always tell him, "My name is Aaron." And he would say, "My name is Moshe. So we're brothers." Because in the Torah, Moses and Aaron are brothers. So he would always say, "We're brothers." And he would slap me in the face and give me a kiss on the cheek every single time. And a slap from him was better than a kiss from anybody. It was with such love. He did that. That was his way, and he did that not to me. He did that to anyone who walked into his house. Everyone would get a slap and a kiss, and he was just an extremely pure soul. There are many stories of people who met him and just changed their lives just after sitting with him for half an hour, because you're sitting in the presence of someone so pure. The Rebbe said about this man that he was a Beinoni, which means that he had control over not just every act that he did, but every word that came out of his mouth and every thought that was entertained in his mind, which means that every deed that he did was positive and holy. Every word that he said was good. He did not say a bad word about anybody. And even the thoughts that he had about people were positive. Not that he couldn't have arisen in his heart a negative thought, but he would never entertain such a thought. He would turn it around immediately. Including somebody who'd hurt him, he would respond with love. If the Rebbe identified him as that, so then that says a lot. And so I was very honored to meet him and to feel his presence. When you're in the presence of a Beinoni, this is not even a tzaddik, this is a Beinoni. But this is a person who is working hard every single moment. He's working very, very hard. He's got total self-control. That is a level that maybe doesn't happen too often, but it's accessible to us. And therefore, Rabbi Shneur Zalman is going to spend a long time now, the next few chapters, telling exactly what a Beinoni is, the possible man. So to conclude, we've studied now, having got to chapter 12 in Tanya, we have a very clear picture now. We've understood from the first few chapters of Tanya that we have two souls, the divine and the animal. We then understood from the next few chapters, 3 and 4, that we have personality, our intellect and emotion, which is our inner world, and we have behavior, the garments of the soul, thought, speech, and action. Now we've got that structure of the soul. We then learned what these parts of the soul want to do. The divine soul is expressed through Torah study and through doing good deeds, doing mitzvahs. The animal soul is expressed through selfish acts. If you're doing something that's not holy or unholy, it depends which way you're doing it. Doing something like eating for the sake of doing mitzvahs and good becomes holy. Eating for selfish reasons becomes unholy. It goes one way or the other. And so therefore the two souls are in battle. Each one wants total control. The animal soul wants total control of our thought, speech, and action, and our hearts and our minds. The divine soul wants exactly the same, wants total control over our heart, our mind, thought, speech, and action, everything about us. Therefore, where you are in your spiritual life will depend on where that battle is up to. The divine soul and the animal soul. A tzaddik is a person whose divine soul has won, has banished the animal soul either completely, or it's completely silenced, and so it has no no say. The complete tzaddik never sins, isn't tempted, and is disgusted by the thought of it because they have no evil in them at all. The incomplete tzaddik also never sins, also is never tempted to, but is not disgusted by it because they still have an animal soul. It's just not apparent in any practical way. The incomplete rasha sins, regrets it, but repeats it. They're stuck in their cycle of sinning, but they do regret it. The complete rasha is someone who sins without even regretting it. They're so entrenched in it, they don't even have regrets. But the beinoni is a new category. Is somebody who does not sin practically, but is tempted to on a daily basis, and yet is in control of their mind, their mouth, and their actions. Their thoughts, speech, and action, they're in total control over. Their personality may still have evil in it. The animal soul is completely intact, is alive and well. The temptations, the urges to do evil are totally there for the beinoni, but they do not act on those, ever. They control themselves completely. And this is something that we can all be. So our exercise for the week is not to become a beinoni. We've got to learn a few chapters before we can actually become one. But let's identify areas in our moral life where you're each one of the five categories. These five categories here, complete tzaddik, incomplete tzaddik, incomplete rasha, complete rasha, and a beinoni. Think about yourself. Where are you a complete tzaddik? What are the good deeds that you do that you would never be tempted not to do it, and you would be horrified to not do that? That's a complete tzaddik. What are the good deeds that you do that you do them all the time, you're never tempted not to, but you're not horrified, you're not disgusted by the possibility of not doing it? What's an area where you do the right thing, but you're tempted not to? It's a struggle every time. That's where you're a beinoni. What are the things where you do wrong, but you regret it? That's an incomplete rasha. And what's the things where you do wrong and you actually don't mind? It doesn't bother you. That's where you're a complete rasha. So not just are each one of us in a category altogether, but each one of us have different areas of our life where we are all five. Could you lift yourself a notch in any of those areas? Could you maybe, from being a complete rasha and not caring about doing something wrong, maybe start to feel something about that and regret it, at least regret it. You're still going to do it, but regret it. Something that you regret, could you start controlling yourself and be a beinoni and not do it? Something that you control yourself and not do it, could you start to transform your heart to not desire it anymore? And something that you have controlled your heart, you don't desire it, but it doesn't disgust you to not do it. Could you lift yourself to be a complete tzaddik in that particular area and reach the highest level? What we're going to see in the next couple of chapters, God willing, is that this beinoni is possible. It's hard work, but it's within the reach of every single one of us. And that we'll see, God willing, next week and onwards.